Church of Christ here in Paris. Remember the seminar that will be in 2 weeks, Strengthening America's Families with Mike Johnson. Please make plans to be here at every lesson, Friday night, Saturday night, and Sunday, as Mike shares with us principles of God's Word that will be a benefit to us at every stage of life. Help us make our families the kind of families that God would have to be, to strengthen our families in Christ. Along those lines, I want to let the congregation know about a program that the church has started today. Parents who have children in our Bible school program have been introduced to it. It's called the Berean program. Berea, on one hand, being a city where Paul preached the gospel in Acts chapter 17, verse 11. Where Luke writes that the Jews in Berea were more noble-minded than the Jews in Thessalonica because they searched the scriptures daily to see if what Paul and Barnabas were preaching was the truth. So this program is called the Berean Program, Berea being an acronym for Bible Enrichment Reaching Every Age. And what we are doing is every stage in the children's lives here at the Parish Church of Christ, they will receive a new Bible. Age-appropriate Bible. When they advance to a new class, then they'll get another Bible, a little bit more advanced, a little bit more challenging reading, so that they will know that the Bible is important in their lives. And we recognize the leadership, the elders, and Sia in this particular being open to the Bible program recognizes that the Bible needs to be appropriate for their age, for their reading level. And so, we would encourage you, as parents especially, to read the Bible with your children. You know, you can take the Gospel of Matthew and read just one chapter a day with your children. Just one chapter a day, and you can read the Gospel of Matthew in a month. And it probably just takes maybe 5 minutes to read one chapter. Then you can take another month and you can read the Gospel of Mark. You'd be halfway finished. You'd be finished with Mark by the middle point of the month. 16 chapters. And you can pick another, maybe one of Paul's letters, and read one, just one chapter a day. We would encourage you to read the Bible with your children, grow with your children by reading God's Word. Today is the first Sunday of October, and so our lesson will be from the life of Christ. Life lessons from Luke. And this particular lesson will come from Luke chapter 20. So I encourage you to turn in your Bible to Luke chapter 20. If you're using the Bible in the pew, it would be page 879. Rebellion in the Vineyard. I was talking to a man on Thursday, and he said, I do not know why people cannot accept Jesus as the Savior. I said, I don't know either. To me, it's pretty plain that Jesus is the Savior. He's the Son of God. It's pretty plain to me that there is a God. Many people simply do not believe that either. Why do people reject Jesus as the Savior? Why? Well, there are a number of reasons why. Some people simply cannot believe that Jesus is God in the flesh. They have a hard time visualizing that the man from Nazareth can be God by nature, that he can be deity. Some people reject Jesus because they do not like his expectations. They don't like the idea of loving your neighbor as yourself. They don't like the idea of praying for your enemies. They don't like the idea of worshiping every Sunday. They just don't like his expectations. Some people don't like the idea of Jesus causes us to focus on the spiritual. You know, it is hard, even for Christians, of course, sometimes, to focus on the world that is not visible. We live in a physical world. We live in a world that has physical demands on us, a material world. And sometimes it's just hard to focus on that which is not seen. And so some people say, I don't want Jesus because I can't focus. Like, I can't live a life like that. Some people reject Jesus because he demands selflessness from us. That really goes against the grain. In our society, it is every man for himself. that's what you've got to do. Put your competitor down and lift yourself up. This idea of selflessness, nobody can make it in this world being selfless. That's what the world thinks. So a lot of people reject Jesus for that reason. Many people reject Jesus because they think they know Him very well. And they think, well, I know that, I've been there, I've done that, I need something new. I need something fresh. And so they're looking for, and that's why the popularity of Eastern religions, that's why we have a popularity of mysticism, the New Age movement, yoga, and things like that in our society. A lot of it is because people think, well, Jesus is old stuff. I need something new. To them, something new is actually something that's older than Jesus. Eastern religions, Buddhism, they're older than Jesus. But they think they know Jesus too well, and so they reject Him. Some people reject Jesus because He calls us out of our comfort zone. Jesus does place expectations on us, and He does push us to do more, to be better. There's a lot of people that are not comfortable with that. I like my life the way it is. I like doing what I want to do on Sunday morning. I want to go fishing on Sunday morning, I want to go fishing. If I want to go play golf on Sunday morning, I go play golf. I want to do what I want to do on Sunday. Jesus calls us out of our comfort zone in so many ways. Some people reject Jesus because popularity of Jesus ebbs and flows in the culture. Back here in the 50s, it was popular to be a Christian. Nowadays, not so much. So people think that they can latch on to something that is more stable than Jesus. So they don't want to be associated with somebody right now who's just not popular. And then some people reject Jesus because they reject the religion that is associated with Jesus, regardless of what shape or form that religion takes. People reject Jesus because they don't want organized religion. Well, we have a parable here in Luke chapter 20 that deals with the Jews' rejection of Jesus. As we go through this parable and as we end the parable, we're going to turn around and take a look at ourselves and our modern society, our modern culture, and ask ourselves, what will keep me from rejecting Jesus? And we'll end our study in the book of Romans. So let's take a look now at the parable itself. Luke chapter 20, verses 9 through 16. Now, as we get into the parable, we always need to ask ourselves, what is going on in the life of Jesus that motivates Him to tell this parable? Now, Luke chapter 20 takes place on Monday before Jesus is betrayed and crucified on Friday. This is the week of His crucifixion. This is dated by scholars as that Monday. And if we go back and look in chapter 19, we see where Jesus has come into the city of Jerusalem riding on the colt. And the people have laid down palm branches in front of Him, and they're singing a song based on Psalms 118. And the Pharisees criticize Jesus for letting the people treat Him as a king. If you look at chapter 19, verse 38, the Jews are crying out to Jesus, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And the Pharisees rebuke Jesus and they say, "You need to tell your disciples to hush up." And Jesus says in verse 40, chapter 19, "I tell you, if these become silent, the stones will cry out." What's He saying? The earth is going to recognize the glory of Jesus Christ. And in fact, they do when Jesus dies on the cross and the ground is opened up and those who are dead rise from the grave. That is the stones crying out, testifying that this man is the Son of God. And then as Jesus approaches Jerusalem, he casts the money changers out of the temple. He cries over the city of Jerusalem because their heart does not belong to God. And He says, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who have killed the prophets and stoned those who have come to you, how often I would have gathered you as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings, and you would not." And so Jesus cries over the city of Jerusalem. And He casts these money changers out. And He tells them in verse 46, My house will be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers. So there's controversy between Jesus and the Jewish leaders here. And at the beginning of chapter 20, the Jewish leaders, the Pharisees, the scribes, the elders, the Sanhedrin, the Jewish Supreme Court, informally come to Jesus and they say, tell us by what authority you're doing these things. My mom used to ask me, who died and left you in charge? And that's what the Pharisees are asking Jesus, who died and left you in charge? And Jesus says there, I will ask you a question, and if you give me an answer, then I will answer your question. His question had to do with the baptism of John. Did John teach this baptism by his own authority, or did he get that authority from heaven? Well, the Pharisees weren't obeying John. The Pharisees did not want to obey John. They didn't want to repent of their sins and follow John's preaching. So they did not believe that John was a prophet from God. So what they wanted to say in their heart was John's preaching was from man. John had no authority to preach what he preached. But they knew that the people accepted John as a prophet. And so now they're going to play politics. I'm not going to answer that he was from man because we'll lose the popularity of the people. But I can't answer that he's from God because I don't believe that. And so the Pharisees say, well, we can't answer your question. And so Jesus says, well, I'm not going to answer your question either. Where I get my authority. But then, he tells this parable to really answer where his authority comes from. So let's read the parable, chapter 20, Luke chapter 20, beginning in verse 9. He began to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard and rented it out to vine growers, and he went on a journey for a long time. And at harvest time, he sends a slave to the vine growers so that they would give him some of the produce of the vineyard. That all makes sense. He's the owner. It's time for him to receive some of his pay. These were tenant farmers, and so they received some of the crops themselves to live on, and they were to give some of the crops to the owner. But the vine growers beat this slave and sent him away empty handed. Now, just on the surface of that is audacious, isn't it? That is audacious to beat the slave of the owner and not give him what he's required to receive. And so verse 11, the owner proceeded to send another slave. And they beat him also and treated him shamefully and sent him away empty-handed. He proceeded to send a third, verse 12. And this one also they wounded and sent away empty-handed. So verse 13, the owner of the vineyard has a high-level cabinet meeting with himself. He says, okay, what am I going to do? Well, I will send my beloved son. Now, he doesn't know how the vine growers are going to respond because he says, perhaps they will respect him. And they will give me the produce that is mine at harvest time. And so he sends his son. When the vine growers, verse 14, saw him, they reasoned with one another, saying, this is the heir. Let us kill him so that the inheritance will be ours. Now, I have not found any legal basis for that reason. But for whatever reason, maybe they thought the landowner was just going to give up and let them have the land if they killed his son. And so that's what they had decided to do. So verse 15, the beloved son of the landowner shows up, and so they throw him out of the vineyard, and they kill the owner's son. They kill the owner's son. And what then, Jesus asks, will the owner of the vineyard do to him? To them? Well, in Matthew's account, the Jews that he's speaking to answers his question. In Luke's account here, Jesus answers it himself. And so maybe that they answered, and now Jesus agrees with their response. Yes, here's what he's going to do. He will come and destroy those.